Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege to welcome you to the evening session of the 16th Annual Study Group for the Pre-Trib Research Center. You might wonder, what is the Pre-Trib Research Center? It's a group of Christians, primarily professors, writers, scholars, ministers, individuals who are interested in the second coming of Jesus Christ, and they want to talk about the details. We've had a wonderful day today and many great presentations, and we'll have some more tomorrow. But tonight, we're going to enjoy a debate. By the way, when we started this group, we had 31 people here in Dallas for our first meeting. Dr. Walvoord was here, Dr. Pentecost, Dr. Charles Ryrie, and a number of other fine scholars, Dr. Toussaint, who's here today. Many of these know the end from the beginning because they're there now, but the rest of us are just waiting in line. But it was said that there weren't enough people interested in prophecy. Today, we've had well over 400 people gathered, and it's growing in momentum. And I have a special message I want to give to you to a Dallas Seminary graduate, Dr. David Jeremiah. Dr. Jeremiah was my successor in one of the churches I pastored in San Diego. He knew we invited him to come, and he had another commitment. And he said, I've got a message for the delegates, to those who say that teaching Bible prophecy is not interesting and not evangelistic, not productive. Tell them that I started a series of 10 prophetic messages, and we charted the service attendance 1 year before and the 10 Sundays of that series, and we had an average increase attendance of 700 people. People are interested in the second coming of Jesus Christ. And it's my privilege to ask you to bow with me as we thank the Lord who is coming for the opportunity. Heavenly Father, as we bow before you, we thank you that you not only sent your Son to save us, to die for us, and to prove your acceptance of his sacrifice, you raised him from the dead. Thank you for the gift of salvation. And the things that we agree on here in this meeting tonight is that God so loved the world that he gave his Son, that whosoever believeth on him should have everlasting life. And we thank you for the privilege of preaching it and teaching it. And we pray that Jesus, our coming Lord, will be glorified in all that we say and do. In his name we pray. Amen. And now may I introduce to you the executive director and the man really responsible for the success of this ministry, Dr. Thomas Ice.
Thank you. Because of the futurism versus preterism interchange, and futurism is the belief that those who interpret the book of Revelation, chapters 4 and following, believe it, that the tribulation, the second coming, and the millennium is future to our own time, whereas preterists believe that all or parts of the book of Revelation were fulfilled in the first century. The date of the book of Revelation is very important. Also, because this year's theme at the Pre-Trib Study Group is the book of Revelation, we thought it was important to deal with the date of the book of Revelation. If the traditional late date of about AD 95 is the correct view, then it renders all forms of the preterist interpretation of the book of Revelation impossible, because Revelation is said to be a prophecy of the future and not a prophecy of the destruction of Jerusalem and the Jewish temple by the Romans in AD 70. However, for the futurist, it does not matter when Revelation was given by the Lord to the Apostle John, since even now, most of its events are futuristic, even to our own day. Therefore, the early date is essential for the preterist position of Revelation to even be considered a possibility. This is why, if it can be demonstrated that the late date is true, then it eliminates the preterist view of Revelation as a possibility. Hank Hanegraaff will advocate and defend a pre-AD 70 date of revelation, while Mark Hitchcock will contend for the AD 95 debate date. Hank Hanegraaff serves as president and chairman of the board of the North Carolina-based Christian Research Institute International. He is also host of the Bible Answer Man radio program, which is the broadcast daily across the United States and Canada, as well as around the world through the internet. Hanegraaff is author of The Prayer of Jesus, Christianity in Crisis, and Resurrection. He also has written, is co-author of a novel called The Fuse of Armageddon, and a Last Disciple fiction trilogy called The Last Disciple, The Last Sacrifice, and the forthcoming The Last Temple. Hanegraaff is a regular contributor to Christian Research Journal and The Plain Truth magazine. He lives with his wife Kathy in North Carolina and are the parents of 9 children as well as 5 grandchildren. Mark Hitchcock has a BS degree from Oklahoma State University, a law degree from Oklahoma City University School of Law, practiced law for 4 years at the Oklahoma Court and Criminal Appeals. He felt called into the ministry and received a THM from Dallas Theological Seminary and recently completed his PhD at Dallas. He's pastor of Faith Bible Church in Edmond, Oklahoma. He's been there for 16 years. He's also adjunct professor of Bible exposition at Dallas Theological Seminary. He is the author of 17 books related to end times prophecy, and he's married to Cheryl and has 2 sons there in Edmond, Oklahoma. We asked Hank if he wanted to go first in the debate, and he decided he would go last. Therefore, Mark Hitchcock is going to go first, and Hank will end the debate. And so, without further delay, we'll ask Mark Hitchcock to come and give his opening 30-minute presentation.
Well, before we get started, I wanted to thank Tim LaHaye and thank Tommy Ice and the Pre-Trib Study Group for hosting this debate. And I want to thank all of you for coming out on a cold, dreary night to be a special part of this event here this evening. And I want to especially thank Mr. Hanegraaff for taking time out of his busy schedule to come into the dispensational lion's den, if you will. You know, it's dispensational, it's like the book of Daniel. So, for this debate, a debate that I pray can be used by the Lord to help us further the understanding for the body of Christ of the book of Revelation. So thank you very much for coming and for participating in this debate with us. There are 2 main dates for the composition of the book of Revelation. There is the Neronic date, written during the time of Nero, or the early date, about AD 65, and the Domitianic date, the late date, that it was written in AD 95, during the reign of Domitian, who ruled from 81 AD to 96 AD. This is the traditional date of the church for the last 1900 years. Now, Tommy's already mentioned this briefly, but why is the date of Revelation so important? In his book, The Last Sacrifice, Mr. Hanegraaff says, much has been made of the differences in the interpretation of Scripture applied by the Last Disciple series and the Left Behind series. One of the key distinctions between the end-time theologies called eschatologies employed by these 2 series has to do with when the writing of the New Testament was completed. The Last Disciple series is based on an interpretation of Scripture that holds the entire New Testament was completed prior to the destruction of the temple in AD 70. In contrast, the Left Behind series is based on the assumption that Revelation was written in AD 95, long after Jerusalem's destruction. And I did note here that Mr. Hanegraaff states that his views based on interpretation of Scripture and our views based on an assumption. Also in the Apocalypse Code, Mr. Hanegraaff says, for LaHaye, everything hinges on proving that the book of Revelation was written long after the destruction of the temple in AD 70. If, like the rest of Scripture, Revelation was written prior to AD 70, his entire Left Behind juggernaut is compromised. Now, these statements really are not accurate. They leave the false impression that Mr. Hanegraaff's view and futurism are both dependent on a particular date for the composition of Revelation. However, the only one of the four major views of Revelation that is date-dependent is preterism or partial preterism. If Revelation was written in AD 65, futurism is still a viable interpretive option. However, if Revelation was written after AD 70, then Revelation 1 through 19 cannot be a prophecy about the events of AD 70, as Mr. Hanegraaff believes. R.C. Sproul, in his book, The Last Days According to Jesus, says if the book was written after A.D. 70, talking about the book of Revelation, then its contents manifestly do not refer to events surrounding the fall of Jerusalem. Partial preterist Ken Gentry says if the late date of around A.D. 95-96 is accepted, a wholly different situation would prevail. The events in the mid and late 60s of the first century would be excluded as possible fulfillments. Mr. Hanegraaff is correct that his view is totally dependent on the AD 65 date. He has hitched his entire eschatological wagon to the AD 65 date. However, he is incorrect in saying that futurism is based on the assumption that Revelation was written in AD 95. Futurism is not based on any particular date of Revelation. We would just simply believe the Apostle John wrote it, and it has to be written after the seven churches that came into existence. It is true that most futurists hold the AD 95 date, but this is simply because they or we believe it is the correct date, not because the view itself is dependent on that date. One consequence, though, of the traditional AD 95 date or any date after AD 70 is that this is fatal to preterism or the idea that Revelation 1 through 19 and those events were fulfilled in the first century. Francis Gumerlach says futurists, on the other hand, generally believe that the book of Revelation contains prophecies, the majority of which will be fulfilled near the end of the world. While a date of Revelation is not crucial to their interpretation of the book, it is important in their polemic against preterism. And Richard Mayhew, who's a member of our Pre-Trib Study Group, says, significantly, a futurist would not have to change his eschatological thinking if a pre-AD 70 date for the writing were to be established. However, the preterist position is eliminated from consideration if the late date of AD 95 can be validated. If Mr. Hanegraaff is correct about the date of Revelation, the futuristic view of Revelation can still be true. There are futurists who hold to the early date of Revelation, such as Zane Hodges. If Revelation was written in AD 95, then Mr. Hanegraaff's view of Revelation 1 through 19 never even gets off the ground. Revelation cannot be prophesying events about Nero and the fall of Jerusalem if it was written after those events occurred. Mr. Hanegraaff's entire eschatological scheme then hangs precariously on the mid-60s date of Revelation. Any date after AD 70, or really any date after June of AD 68, because he believes it was written during Nero's reign and he died in June of AD 68, then that's fatal to his view. And this is the essential problem for Mr. Hanegraaff's position. He's constructed his entire eschatological framework on a point, the AD 65 date of Revelation, that at best is improbable and at worst is untenable. That is why he has to defend the mid-60s date so vigorously and can't give an inch. If he does, his entire view falls apart. Now, what about the burden of proof in this debate? Early date advocates, I believe, have the burden of proof since the AD 95 date is the accepted traditional date. Partial preterist R.C. Sproul admits the burden for preterists then is to demonstrate that Revelation was written before AD 70. Now, there are two lines of evidence for dating New Testament books. There's external evidence, evidence from outside the book, and then internal evidence, evidence from inside the book itself. And we want to consider both of those in dating the book of Revelation, as really that we do with all other New Testament books. Now, the main arguments for the AD 65 date that are presented, Mr. Hanegraaff in his book, The Last Sacrifice, says, in summary, from all the reasons we are well justified in believing that the book of Revelation was not written 25 years after the destruction of Jerusalem, three tower above the rest. So Mr. Hanegraaff develops what he calls three towers from the internal evidence for the AD 65 date. His first argument is that if Revelation was written in 95 AD, that it's inconceivable that John would not have mentioned the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. The second tower is, there's no mention of the fulfillment of Jesus' prophecy of the destruction of Jerusalem in Matthew 25. And he also believes it would be inconceivable for John not to mention the fulfillment of this prophecy. Now you notice these first two arguments are arguments from silence. And the third argument, the third tower, is that John mentions the Jewish temple is intact when he writes. So since a temple's mentioned, he believes it has to be the temple that was destroyed in AD 70, so John has to have written before that time. Now here's the answers to the first tower, that there's no mention of the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70 in Revelation. Two answers to this. First, the audience for Revelation was Gentile believers in Asia Minor in AD 95. The destruction of the temple was a Jewish event 800 miles away and 25 years in the past. It was remote from the original audience ethnically, geographically, and historically. Second, Revelation is not a history, it is a prophecy. The book begins by telling us it's a prophecy, and at the end, these are like bookend statements for the book. The book of Revelation deals with the future, not the past. John was taken in a vision to the future and told repeatedly to write down what he saw. The words, "and I saw," occur about 44 times in the book of Revelation. The destruction of Jerusalem, an event 25 years in the past, was not part of the vision of the future that he received. Now, Revelation 1:19 is key to this because you remember that John is instructed by Jesus himself, "Write therefore the things you've seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after these things." If John is writing in AD 95, he is not at liberty to write about the past because he is commanded by the risen, glorified Christ himself, write what you've just seen, write the things that are presently, and write the things that are future. If John had written about something that was past in AD 95, he would have been disobeying the direct command from Jesus Christ himself to write about the present and to write about the future. That's why there's no mention of the destruction of Jerusalem in the book of Revelation. Now the second tower is there's no mention of the fulfillment of Jesus' prophecy of the destruction of Jerusalem. Mr. Hanegraaff says, as the student of the New Testament well knows, New Testament writers were quick to highlight fulfilled prophecy. The phrase, "this was to fulfill what was spoken of by the prophets," permeates the pages of Scripture and demonstrates conclusively that the Bible is divine rather than human in origin. Thus, it is inconceivable that Jesus would make an apocalyptic prophecy concerning the destruction of Jerusalem and the Jewish temple, and that John would fail to mention that the prophecy was fulfilled one generation later, just as Jesus predicted it. The problem that I see with Mr. Hanegraaff's statement here is that the book of Revelation never does this with any prophecy. Revelation does not contain the formula, "this was to fulfill what was spoken of by the prophet," not one time. There are hundreds of allusions to Old Testament prophecies in the book of Revelation, but there are no fulfillment formulas in the book of Revelation for any other prophecy, so why would we expect it to be there for this one? The answer to the third tower, that John mentions the Jewish temple as intact at the time he wrote. It is true that John mentions a temple in Revelation 11, 1 and 2, but this does not mean it had to be standing at the time he wrote. Daniel in Daniel 9, that was written in 538 BC, and Ezekiel 40 through 43, which was written in 573 BC, both of these men mention literal temples that were not standing at the time they wrote. Daniel 9, Ezekiel 40 to 43. John followed this same familiar Old Testament pattern and described an end-time temple. Mr. Hanegraaff says that Revelation is a virtual recapitulation of Ezekiel. Now, if that's true, and if Ezekiel, writing 13 years after the temple was destroyed, talks about a future temple, why wouldn't we expect John to do the very same thing if the book of Revelation is a recapitulation of the book of Ezekiel? So there's Old Testament precedent for this from the book of Daniel and the book of Ezekiel, these books that John relied upon so heavily in writing the Apocalypse. So these are Mr. Hanegraaff's three towers for the AD 65 date. Now, a couple of other internal arguments for the AD 65 date. I know we'll talk about these in more detail, but Mr. Hanegraaff points out how the words "soon" and "near" are used in the book of Revelation. And his view of these terms is that they mean that the events that are prophesied had to happen within a few years of the time that the revelation was given. The problem I see with that is the strategic location of these timing terms. Notice the word soon is the word takos. It's used in chapter 1, verse 1, then at the very end of the book as well. And the word ingus, so near at hand, is used in chapter 1, verse 3, then again at the end. So these terms serve as bookends or like an inclusio for all the material in the book of Revelation. So whatever meaning you give to these terms must account for all the material in the book. The problem that I see, the inconsistency in Mr. Hanegraaff's interpretation, is he takes Revelation 1 through 19 as having been fulfilled in a few years after he believes Revelation was written in 65 AD, yet in Revelation 20, he still sees a future second coming, the great white throne judgment, and the new heaven and the new earth, which obviously those things didn't happen soon or near, according to his definition. Everything in the book has to happen within whatever definition we give of soon and near. My understanding of those terms is they speak of imminency, that these are events that could break in upon the world at any time. Because John in 1 John 2 says, little children, it is the last hour. This time we live in, this age is the last hour. This age is the last days. And so these events are soon or near or at hand. That is, they could break in upon the world anytime. Really, if you're going to be consistent and take these terms and be consistent with soon and near, you either have to be a futurist or you have to be a full preterist. You really can't be a partial preterist and maintain consistency. One other argument that I'm sure we'll talk about probably some more here a little bit later is that Nero is the beast of Revelation 13. It's maintained that in the Hebrew language that if you take the word Neron Caesar and convert that to the gematria value, the numerical value, that does equal 666. The problems with this view are that Nero was never associated with the beast of Revelation 13 until at least the 5th century, and really not a lot until the 1830s by four German preterists. The early church consistently applied Revelation 13 to a future final Antichrist, Irenaeus, Andreas, Victorinus, Primacius. The second thing is you have to use the name Nero and the title Caesar to get 666. Revelation 13 says the number of his name will be 666. It's going outside the text of Scripture. Also, you have to use what I believe is a defective spelling. Also, you have to use Hebrew. The language of the audience John's writing to is Greek. You have to use a Hebrew name or title that would have not been familiar to most of the audience. But really, the strongest argument is simply that Nero did not fulfill the prophecies of Revelation 13. Who was the second beast who gives honor to the first beast? Never heard that satisfactorily answered by preterists. What about the image that comes to life? What about the charagma or the mark on the right hand to buy or to sell? If you're going to take the number 666 literally in this passage, you have to take the other things in the passage literally as well. And they simply don't fit what we know about the life and the reign of Nero. Now, what's the external evidence for the traditional AD 95 date of Revelation? The first witness for the late date is Hegesippus, writing in AD 150. He was born about 15 years after the book of Revelation was written. He wrote his memoirs, which are five treatises that he wrote. Hegesippus is one of the key sources that Eusebius, and we'll talk about him in a few minutes, the father of church history, used to formulate his opinion that John was banished to Patmos under the Emperor Domitian, who was the Roman emperor from AD 81 to 96. So this is the first witness about 55 years after the book of Revelation was written. Exhibit A for the late date is Irenaeus. Irenaeus was born in about 120 AD. He was the bishop of Lyon in southern France. He was born and raised in Smyrna, which is one of the cities that the book of the Revelation was addressed to, written to. He was discipled by Polycarp, who in turn, Polycarp was a disciple of the Apostle John. And Irenaeus wrote against heresies in AD about 170 or 180. Now this is the statement of Irenaeus. When he's talking here about 666 and the Antichrist, he says, "We will not, however, incur the risk of pronouncing positively as to the name of the Antichrist. For if it were necessary that his name should be distinctly revealed in this present time, it would have been announced by him who beheld the apocalyptic vision, for that is the apocalyptic vision, was seen no very long time since, but almost in our own day, towards the end of Domitian's reign." Writing in 170 AD, Irenaeus, who grew up in Smyrna, who knew Polycarp, who knew the Apostle John, says that the apocalyptic vision was seen towards the end of Domitian's reign, and Domitian's reign ended in 96 AD. Now, there's three objections to the testimony of Irenaeus. Objection number one is that Irenaeus was ambiguous. Mr. Hanegraaff says, "First, it is instructive to note that the late dating for Revelation is largely dependent on a single and markedly ambiguous sentence in the writings of Irenaeus, Bishop of Lyon. This sentence can be taken to mean that either John or that John's apocalyptic vision was seen toward the end of Domitian's reign." Now, there's two answers to this objection. First of all, the statement simply is not ambiguous. The apocalyptic vision is the nearest antecedent, for that was seen no very long time since, but almost in our own day, towards the end of Domitian's reign. And let's be honest, if this statement said at the end of Nero's reign, Mr. Hanegraaff would be using it as a slam dunk for his view. Secondly, the first person we know of to suggest that this statement was ambiguous was Johann Jacob Wettstein, a German preterist, in 1752. No Greek speaker for 1,650 years ever questioned that this statement referred to when John saw the apocalyptic vision. J. Ritchie Smith, writing in 1888, said, "It is a sufficient answer to all these forced interpretations that the early church always understood the words of Irenaeus in their plain and obvious meaning, nor would any other have been suggested if his testimony had not been a stumbling block in the way of modern exposition." Number two is that Irenaeus was mistaken. Mr. Hanegraaff loves to point out how Irenaeus made one error in his writings concerning the chronology of Jesus' ministry. Irenaeus said that Jesus lived to be almost 50 years old and his ministry spanned a period almost 15 years. That was an interpretive error that I agree Irenaeus was mistaken there from John chapter 8, where, you know, Jesus said, you know, "I've seen Abraham." They say, "How'd you see Abraham's day? You're not even 50 years old." So based on that passage, he made an interpretive error. But it's a lot different to make an interpretive error about a passage than it is to be wrong about a historical fact. The date of Revelation is a historical fact. By the way, who here hasn't made an interpretive error in the Bible? You know, all of his writings, this is the only error I've ever seen pointed to that Irenaeus made. And it's an interpretation, not about a historical fact that was commuted to him by Polycarp. No one was in a better position to know the date of Revelation than Irenaeus. Irenaeus was also very specific about the date of Revelation. He narrowed it down to a period at the end of the reign of Domitian. This gives even more credibility and confidence to his testimony. Philip Schaff, in his classic work, History of the Christian Church, says, "Irenaeus is the leading representative of Catholic Christianity in the last quarter of the second century, the champion of orthodoxy against Gnostic heresy. He united a learned Greek education and philosophical penetration with practical wisdom and moderation. He is neither very original nor brilliant, but eminently sound and judicious. His position gives him additional weight, for he is linked by two long lives, that of his teacher and grand teacher, to the fountainhead of Christianity." A third objection is that Irenaeus simply parroted other people after him. The problem here is that you can't have it both ways. If Irenaeus was so ambiguous and even mistaken about the date of Revelation, why did everybody follow him? Moreover, while it is true that Irenaeus is a key source for the dating of Revelation, many key historical facts can be traced to a single source. Every tradition has a beginning point. This is inherent in the nature of historical evidence. And what more reliable source could we have than Irenaeus, who knew Polycarp and grew up in Smyrna? Origen said the king of the Romans, as tradition teaches, condemned John, who bore testimony on account of the word of truth to the Isle of Patmos. The only tradition we know about is the tradition from Irenaeus. Origen can be counted. Victorinus was the author of the earliest known Latin commentary on Revelation, the first great exegete of the Western Church. As a commentator on Revelation, we can assume that he took a great interest in when the book was written. When John said these things, he was on the island of Patmos, condemned to the labor of the mines by Caesar Domitian. There, therefore, he saw the apocalypse. The time must be understood in which the written apocalypse was published, since then reigns Caesar Domitian. Eusebius, the father of church history, who sat at the right hand of Constantine at the Council of Nicaea, he says, but after Domitian had reigned 15 years and Nerva succeeded to the empire, it was at this time that the Apostle John returned from his banishment in the island and took up his abode in Ephesus, according to an ancient Christian tradition. And I won't read the other quote by him. Jerome is the one who translated the Bible into Latin. Jerome, and against Jovinianum, wrote that John was a prophet, for he saw on the island of Patmos, to which he'd been banished by the Emperor Domitian as a martyr for the Lord, an apocalypse containing boundless mysteries of the future. Lives of illustrious men, he says the same thing. Mr. Hanegraaff, remember, says, the late dating of Revelation is largely dependent on a single and markedly ambiguous sentence in the writings of Irenaeus. Is this really true? And what is the external evidence for the AD 95 date? I want to put this side by side so you can see it. On the AD 95 side, you have Agesippus, Irenaeus, Clement of Alexandria, Tertullian, Origen, Dio Cassius, Victorinus, Eusebius, Jerome, Sulpicius Severus, Paulus Orosius, Primacius, who writes the second Latin commentary on the book of Revelation that we still have. The first witness for the AD 65 date is a superscription, one-line superscription, and a Syriac version of the New Testament in 508. And then again in 616, and then Arethus in 850, and then finally a man named Theophylact in 1100. That's the external evidence for the book of Revelation. The late date has an overwhelming line of support from some of the greatest, most reliable names in church history. These witnesses come from different and widespread geographical regions of the church. And I'm not going to read these quotes by different men here. One stubborn question remains for Mr. Hanegraaff and other early date advocates. If the AD 65 date for Revelation is correct, this means it had a running 30-year head start on the late date. If this were true, why was it not the overwhelming view of the early church? Why did it take 400 years for it to appear? The early date would have enjoyed every advantage to establish itself as the accepted date by the church fathers. Yet the opposite is true. The AD 95 date became the accepted dominant date from the middle of the second century until the 21st century. Why is that? Because it is the date when Revelation was written by John on the island of Patmos. Let me just hasten here to some of the internal evidence for the AD 95 date. According to church tradition, John did not even come to Asia until the middle to the late AD 60s, according to F.F. Bruce in New Testament History, which would not have allowed John time to settle in Asia, replace Paul as the leader of the Asian churches, and then be exiled to Patmos before Nero's death. A second argument I have is there's no mention of Paul or his work in Asia in the letters to the seven churches. If Revelation was written in the mid-60s, there would have been an overlap of Paul's letters, 1st and 2nd Timothy, which were written in the mid-60s, to the church at Ephesus at the same time Revelation was being written there. Yet John makes no mention of Paul. Paul makes no mention of John. Paul makes no mention of the Nicolaitan heir. It's spoken of in the book of Revelation. You have these letters crisscrossing or overlapping at the same place. The absence of any mention of Paul by John is inexplicable, I believe. Also, a third argument is the severe spiritual decline of five of the seven churches would require an extended period of time, not a few years. Ephesus has lost its first love. Pergamum has Nicolaitan error. Thyatira has fallen into the deep things of Satan. Sardis, the church of Sardis, is dead. Laodicea is so rich and arrogant the Lord wants to vomit them out of his mouth. Now, these churches were founded primarily during Paul's third missionary journey in the mid to late 50s. So within 10 years, less than 10 years, five of the seven churches are so bad that the Lord's going to come remove their lampstands. This fits the AD 95 date much better. I mean, if it had just been one or two churches, maybe you could say, yeah, in that short a period of time, but five of them are in this condition. It suits a time much later than 65 AD. Number four, the Polycarp, the bishop of Smyrna, said that the church of Smyrna did not even exist at the time of Paul's ministry. Yet Revelation 2, 8 through 11 indicates the church had been suffering persecution for some time when John wrote to them. Number five, and I'll talk about this more later, Laodicea suffered a devastating earthquake in AD 60. The rebuilding of the city spanned a period of 30 years. Yet in the Laodicean letter, it says they're rich, they don't have need of anything, and yet in 65 AD, they were just in the first years of a building program that would span a period of 30 years. Number six, Revelation 1:9 says that John was exiled to the island of Patmos when he received the apocalypse. There's no evidence that Nero banished Christians as Christians, yet we know that Domitian banished Flavia Domitilla to an island for her faith in Christ in AD 95, the same year. Also, why would Nero execute Paul and Peter and yet banish John? The different sentences for Paul and Peter and for John argue for different emperors. Finally, one last argument. Revelation 2:13 says that Antipas of Pergamum was martyred for his faith in Christ. Tradition records that Antipas was roasted alive in AD 92 in a brazen-shaped bull altar. In a brazen bull-shaped altar. Obviously, Revelation had to be written after this event took place. So the AD 65 date, the external evidence is no clear support until AD 508, 400 years after Revelation was written. The internal evidence are Mr. Hanegraaff's three towers, two of which are arguments from silence. On the other hand, the AD 95 date, the external evidence is a solid line of support beginning in AD 50 from the luminaries of the early church, men that Mr. Hanegraaff, as we're going to see later in the debate, actually relies on for other information. The internal evidence is seven arguments that strongly suggest, and in some cases, even require the late date. So Mr. Hanegraaff's first external witness for the date of Revelation is 400 years after Revelation was written. Now, to give us a little perspective on that, Jamestown, I think, was founded in 1607, and today it's 2007. It's 400 years. The first witness externally to the Neronic date, the 65 date of the book of Revelation, was 400 years after these events took place. Between that time, you have the luminaries of the early church saying this is when the book was written. So the conclusion that I come to from looking at the external evidence, the internal evidence, is that the traditional AD 95 date stands firm and Mr. Hanegraaff's eschatological scheme falls. Thank you.
Mr. Hanegraaff has 30 minutes for his opening remarks.
The first thing I'd like to say in my opening remark is that I am not a partial preterist, and I have made that abundantly clear in my writing, in my speaking, on radio, on television, and certainly have made it abundantly clear in my books as well. I've clearly indicated that I have a great deal of difficulty with the partial preterist method of interpreting the book of Revelation. So while it is true that I believe that many things have been fulfilled in the past, I also think that many things are going to be fulfilled in the future. So I don't think that the futurist label nor the partial preterist label is particularly helpful. I think it's critical to recognize, however, that the reason I make this distinction has to do with how you read the book of Revelation. It has to do with the art and science of biblical interpretation. As I start my remarks this evening, I would like to just take a few moments with all of you who love the Word of God to actually draw our attention back to the Word of God. Because after all, this is the testimony of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who testifies to everything he saw, that is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. John to the seven churches in the province of Asia. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from among the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the peoples of the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos. I was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write what you see on a scroll and send it to the seven churches, Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking with me, and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands, someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet with a golden sash around his chest. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow. His eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace. And his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all of its brilliance, and when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he laid his right hand on me and said, do not be afraid. I am the first. I am the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys to death and Hades. Write therefore what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. The seven lampstands are the seven churches. Now, the first thing we see in the testimony of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place, is that these are letters to seven churches in the epicenter of a Caesar cult. From Jupiter Julius, who was the father of the Roman Empire and was voted into the hierarchy of gods as divine Julius by the Roman Senate, to Nero Claudius Caesar Augustus Germanicus, who was worshipped as Almighty God, the Caesars would deify themselves as gods. Octavius, the second Roman Caesar, took on the moniker Augustus, meaning worthy of reverence and worship. Upon the death of Tiberius, the Roman Senate awarded the city of Smyrna the privilege of building a temple in which to worship him as Almighty God. Caligula was so convinced of his own divinity that he purposed to have a colossal image of himself erected in the Jewish temple in Jerusalem. For Claudius, the spiritual supremacy of the state was paramount. His philosophy summed up in the phrase, Caesar is Lord, And this pretense was not only common among the Caesars, but also common among the citizens. One need only think back to the jeers of the Jews in Jerusalem when Pilate presented Jesus Christ to them as King of the Jews. In one voice they roar back, "Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar. Shall I crucify your king?" To which they respond, "We have no king but Caesar." Indeed, a generation later, when Nero succeeds Claudius on the throne, he's worshipped not only as Lord, but as Savior. And it's in this milieu that John admonishes the seven churches to stand firm in the conviction that Christ, not Caesar, is both Savior and Lord. They, as the bride of Christ, will face the tyrant's brandished steel, the lion's gory mane, the fires of 1,000 deaths. But in the end, though they suffer persecution for 10 days, those who do not worship the beast or his image and do not receive his mark on their foreheads or their hands will reign with Christ for 1,000 years. Whenever we start talking about dating a book, I think it's important to understand the essence of the book. And Revelation is a wedding covenant from first to last, from Alpha to Omega. It starts with these seven letters to a persecuted bride that is going to face the full fury of not only the woman who rides the beast, but a Roman beast. And it continues with the noxious vision of a prostituted bride. In graphic Old Testament images, we see the judgment of God written on a seven-sealed scroll, announced by seven angels with seven trumpets, depicting seven plagues that are about to befall a bride in bed with a beast. And this pattern of sevenfold judgment ought to be familiar to every one of us because we have encountered it in Scripture. There's a pattern. And the pattern of sevenfold judgment, as all of you know, was announced way back in the Old Testament in the book of Leviticus. Seven times God is warning his people that they are going to be judged four times over. Or put another way, four times God warns that there is a sevenfold judgment that will befall his people. In like fashion, the imagery of sevenfold judgment against a prostituted bride is unveiled on four occasions in the book of Revelation. And of course, Revelation then crescendos with the unveiling of a purified bride who is carried over the threshold of Jordan by a bridegroom who has seven eyes and seven horns into a new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven, prepared as a bride, beautifully adorned for her husband. And we hear a loud voice from the throne saying, "Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. God himself will be with them and be their God. They will be his people. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There'll be no more death, mourning, crying, or pain. For the old order of things will have passed away. All things have become new." It is crucial for us to know to whom the book was written and the essence of the book itself. It is equally crucial to understand the genre of the book of Revelation, because Revelation is not just an apocalypse in the sense of an unveiling. It is an apocalypse in the sense of a linguistic matrix that draws its life-giving water from the wellspring of the Old Testament scriptures. Consider for a moment the tree of life that we encounter in the letter to Ephesus, first encountered in the first book of the Bible, and then re-encountered in the very last pages of Revelation, where the angel shows John the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb. Down the middle of the great street of the city, on each side of the river, stands the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The manna that is promised to the church at Pergamum first falls from heaven in Exodus. The Thyatira, Jezebel, who promotes sexual immorality in that church, is a mirror image of the Jezebel we have already encountered in Kings and Chronicles. The rebuke to the church at Laodicea, "My son, do not reject the discipline of the Lord or loathe his reproof, for whom the Lord loves, he reproves even as a father the son in whom he delights," first fell from the lips of Solomon in the book of Proverbs. Or consider for a moment what all of you have been studying. There's probably not a person here that hasn't memorized it. Revelation chapter 6, that epic depiction of the Lamb opening the sixth seal. And suddenly there's an earthquake. And then the sun turns black like sackcloth made out of goat hair. The whole moon turns blood red. The stars fall from the sky as late figs drop from a fig tree when shaken by a strong wind. And then the sky recedes like a scroll rolling up, and every mountain and island is removed from its place. The reason I say every one of you is familiar with these words is you've heard them many times before, because you're all biblical students. We've heard them fall from the lips of the Lord Jesus Christ in the Olivet Discourse after he has pronounced the temple desolate. He's walking away, and the disciples call his attention to its buildings. "Do you see all these things?" says Jesus. "I tell you the truth, not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." And then later on, Jesus is sitting on the Mount of Olives, and he's surrounded by his disciples, and they ask, "When will this happen? What will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age?" And Jesus gives them a specific answer. "This generation will not pass away until all these things have been fulfilled." Now, this means this. This does not mean that. Unless, of course, you're exercising Clintonian grammar. It all depends on what the meaning of the word is. Jesus is sitting on the Mount of Olives. He's surrounded by his disciples, and he says, "Immediately after the distress of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken." In other words, Jesus and John are talking about the same thing, and Jesus quite obviously is speaking about the destruction of the temple. "Not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." But even that is not sufficient, because all of you, no doubt, even now are thinking, "I've heard those words before," and indeed we have. They emanate from the lips of Isaiah when he's speaking about the destruction of Babylon. And Isaiah says, "See, the day of the Lord is coming, a cruel day with wrath and fierce anger, to make the land desolate and destroy the sinners within it. The rising sun will be darkened. The moon will not give its light. The stars and their constellations will not show their light." If we read Scripture in light of Scripture, we will be able to properly understand the Scriptures. So again, Revelation is not just an apocalypse in the sense of an unveiling, but a linguistic matrix that draws its nourishing sap from the tree of the Old Testament canon. Revelation is not a book of riddles originating from a shallow post-Christian mind. It is a book of symbols that are rooted in Scripture. But Revelation is also epistolary, isn't it? It has an introduction and it has a benediction. "John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia, grace and peace." And then it has the benediction. "He who testifies to these things says, 'Yes, I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen. One must not suppose that there's any need whatsoever to read strained foreign connotations into straightforward communication in the introduction of Revelation. Soon means soon, and near means near. Now, I'm going to contextualize that for you later on. It'll be part of the debate. But soon means soon. Jesus is not linguistically challenged in the least. I think the primary issue that we're going to be debating this issue is, who is our authority? Is our authority Hegesippus? Is our authority Irenaeus, Victorinus? Is it Eusebius, the church historian? One thing that Dr. Hitchcock did not make plain here tonight is that while Eusebius can be lauded as a church historian, he was not a scientist in a white lab coat. He had a reason for late dating the book of Revelation. One must never forget, and I suppose all of you probably know this, one must never then forget that Eusebius did not even believe that the Apostle John wrote the book of Revelation. Indeed, Eusebius believed that the book of Revelation was responsible for the millennial madness that had descended upon the early church, and did not believe that the book of Revelation belonged in the canon of Scripture. So hopefully we can all agree that Eusebius was wrong. I have spent a lot of time personally in the book of Revelation. I love that book, and certainly believe that it is the inerrant, inspired, authoritative Word of God. So my authority is not Victorinus, it's not Irenaeus, it's not any of the church fathers. It is the Word of God. I'm not going to test the Word of God in light of the fathers. I'm going to test the fathers in light of the Word of God. Early on in church history, the fathers that had been lauded here tonight embraced all kinds of doctrines that we find anathema: the perpetual virginity of Mary, baptismal regeneration, the demonization of Jews in the centuries following the death of Christ. Which is to say, if we are biblical Christians, we would never have followed in their train. We would have known the words of Isaiah chapter 18, not just a verse, but an entire chapter devoted to demonstrating that the sins of the Father do not remit to the sons, nor do the sins of the sons remit to the fathers. So we wouldn't have followed the church fathers in demonizing Jews in the second, third, fourth, fifth centuries, and so on. When we're interpreting the book of Revelation, we want to look at the text. And what does the text tell us? I think that all of us should take the time, if we're involved in this debate, to memorize the text, to meditate on the text, and to mine that text for all it's worth. For example, if you read Revelation chapter 17, it tells the story of seven kings, five who have fallen, one who is, and the other has not yet come. And by the way, the title by which the Bible refers to kings is Caesar. Caesar is the family name of Julius Caesar, which makes Julius Caesar, the first Caesar, which of course is conceded by Suetonius, Josephus, Dio Cassius, Sibylline oracles, etc. The point is simply to say that the internal evidence tells us that the sixth king was on the throne, the sixth Roman Caesar. And we can go through the litany of Caesar, starting with Julius Caesar, and Octavius, and Tiberius, and Caligula, and Claudius, and we end up with a Nero Caesar. Not only so, but the book of Revelation tells us explicitly that with wisdom and insight, John's readers are going to be able to identify both the number of the beast and the number of his name. They're going to be able to identify a beast with wisdom and insight. And we are now left, if we take Dr. Hitchcock's view, with the notion that Jesus is befuddling his first century church with riddles that they cannot comprehend. This, by the way, is also true of the letter to Philadelphia. I'm going to save you from that hour of trial that's going to come upon the whole earth. We have Dr. LaHaye suggesting that is a text that is referring to a pre-tribulational rapture. And if that's true, Jesus is tricking the church at Philadelphia by telling them, I'm going to save you from a trial, when in reality the trial had nothing to do with them whatsoever. It had to do with Dr. LaHaye and his 21st century left-behind audience. I'd like to conclude with the three points already cited by Dr. Hitchcock with respect to giving pause to those who are overly dogmatic about the late dating of the book of Revelation. I hold to the fact that if John were indeed writing in AD 95, he would most certainly have mentioned the most apocalyptic event in Jewish history. Here you have the very center that gave the Jews their theological and sociological identity being destroyed. Dr. Hitchcock himself acknowledges that if this had been written 2, 3, 4, 5 years after the destruction of Jerusalem, it would have been, to use his words, crazy, not to mention it. Well, indeed, it would be crazy. And the suggestion that Revelation doesn't deal with history must surely stretch all of our credulity beyond the breaking point. All you have to do is open the book of Revelation and read it. It is a recapitulation of Old Testament history, from the fall in Eden to Elijah shutting up the sky for 3.5 years, to judgment on Babylon, to the tree of life that I mentioned previously. To suggest it does not recapitulate the judgments of God in graphic detail is simply to miss the point. And now we have the most apocalyptic event in Jewish history, and someone writing after the fact is not going to mention it. Let me quote my friend Josh McDowell, who says, most liberal scholars today are being forced to consider, this is strong language, forced to consider earlier dates for the New Testament. Indeed, says Josh, John A.T. Robinson comes to some startling conclusions in his groundbreaking book, Redating the New Testament. His research has led to his conviction that the whole of the New Testament was written before the fall of Jerusalem in A.D. 70. John Ankerberg, who I see sitting right here, has written this. It is becoming an increasingly persuasive argument that all the New Testament books were written before AD 70, within a single generation of the death of Christ. Imagine this, Jesus makes an apocalyptic prophecy on which his divinity hinges. And it is fulfilled in graphic detail precisely as he said it would be. And imagine that the New Testament writers do not seize upon that fulfilled prophecy in light of the fact that this was to fulfill, permeates the pages of Scripture. And to say that Gentiles living 800 miles from Jerusalem wouldn't have cared about this is, I want to temper my language here, but is surprising, to say the least. Of course they would have cared about it. This is a primary apologetic that we use today to demonstrate the deity of Jesus Christ. This is the way we combat those who now discount the precious word of the Lord Jesus Christ, like Bart Ehrman. And yes, I do think that the temple was intact when John was writing. He's told to take a measuring rod and to measure the temple of God and the altar and count the worshipers there, but to exclude the outer court, do not measure it, for it has been given to the Gentiles. They will trample on the holy city for 42 months. If Dr. Hitchcock is looking for his ubiquitous 3.5 years, he need look no farther. The temple, very clearly, is intact, and the notion that this is analogous to what was written in Ezekiel chapter 40, is simply wrong. Ezekiel was never told to measure a temple because the temple had already been destroyed. A heavenly angel measures the temple very much like what happens in the book of Revelation. Remember the angel who had one of the seven bowls, who had the seven plagues? He takes John up to a mountain and shows him the holy city coming down out of heaven from God. It shone with the glory of God, and its brilliance was like a very precious jewel, like a jasper clear as crystal. It wasn't John that measured that city. The angel had a measuring rod of gold, and he measured the city, its gates and its walls. Found that the city walls were 144 cubits thick by man's measurement, which the angel was using, pregnant with meaning, of course. So this idea that there's a parallel between Revelation chapter 11 and Ezekiel 40 is simply not true. There's a parallel between Ezekiel 40 and Revelation chapter 21. Let me conclude with the words of Norm Geisler, also a preterist, who said, "If you and your fellow followers write accounts of Jesus after the city and the temple are destroyed in AD 70, aren't you going to at least mention that unprecedented national, human, economic, and religious tragedy somewhere in your writings, especially since the risen Jesus had predicted it?" Of course. And by the way, that's a small snippet out of a number of pages in which he makes a compelling argument for the fact that the late dating doesn't make any sense. Ultimately, the question here tonight is, how are we going to interpret Scripture? Are we going to follow the rallying cry of the Protestant Church, sola scriptura? Or are we going to make our decisions based on church fathers that embraced all kinds of doctrines that we today, as Protestants, do not embrace?